Todd. At Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd. At Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren.
At Rundgren. Bye. That's Todd.
But I'd like to begin with your growing up in Philadelphia. A lot of the people I talk to, they think that you're British.
Well, I grew up in a post-war housing development, in the familiar row house style of the Northeast, and it was pretty much culturally stultifying, I suppose, because there was no character at all to the neighborhood. Generally, not a particularly culturally enriching environment. When I was growing up, my dad, he didn't really like rock and roll music and didn't want it played in the house, but he still liked music. So I got exposed to a lot of contemporary classical music and show tunes. To this day, I can recite, you know, whole operettas. So me and like my best friend, we would learn the entire Gilbert and Sullivan libretto just to prove how smart we were.
Love unrequited robs me of my rest. Love, hopeless love, my heart and soul encumbers. Love, nightmare-like, lies heavy on me chest and weaves itself into my midnight slumber. You're lying awake with a dismal headache and repose that's troubled by anxiety. I can see you may use any language you choose to indulge in without propriety. But your brain is on fire, the bedclothes conspire of usual slumber to plunder you. Pressure counterbeam goes and uncovers your toes and your sheets lips demurely from under you. Next the biking tickles, you feel like Smick Pickle, so terrible sharp is the pricking. And you're hot and you're cross and you tumble and toss till there's nothing twixt you and the ticking. Next the bedclothes will creep to the ground in a heap and you pick them all up in a tangle. Next your pillow resigns and politely declines to remain at its usual angle. Will you get some repose in the form of a dose with hot eyeballs and head ever aching?
So I always wanted to be a guitar player when I was growing up. And when the Beatles came around, it was the perfect opportunity because here was a self-contained group of four people. They did all of their own writing. They did all of their own singing. If they needed other instruments, they figured out how to play them themselves. And so this became the model after that of, you know, of what I would do and become and what everybody that I knew who was interested in music would do and or become.
I really enjoyed the Beatles. They had a great impact on me. But I think the thing that really made the biggest difference for me about the Beatles was not just the music, but the fact that they represented a lifestyle. Previously for me, I just didn't seem to fit into anything and could not even envision what I was going to do with the rest of my life. When I saw that, I realized that's what I want to do.
Rundgren, now a seasoned blues musician, strikes out on his own, leaving home on his 18th birthday. He then joins Woody's Truck Stop, a local blues band. He is immediately a star.
See that new drummer that's with the truck stop?
Yeah, he's really out of sight,
yeah,
man.
He's pretty good.
Excuse me. Hey, who's that guy with the guitar over there?
So after like 9 months of being in Woody's Truck Stop, and they all decided to take acid and go to the country and get their heads together, I decided that wasn't for me. I wanted to do a little more hardcore thing with a British influence, so I put together the Nazz that was sort of modeled after The Who. Yeah, a little Beatles and a little Beach Boys, and some Yardbirds as well, but heavy on the jamming and arm flailing and things like that. And we had no material yet. I had yet to write a song ever. I had to write some songs, wrote a bunch of guitar songs. And then I accidentally wrote Hello, It's Me, and it wound up on the first Nazz record. Actually the B-side of our first single, and it got flipped and got some radio airplay, and that was the first kind of musical success we experienced.
Interesting sort of experiment in pop music publicity and manipulation and things like that. It's not that the band wasn't able to play or the band wasn't any good, but our manager was a former publicist, and so he had a lot of connections, and he wanted to build up our image way in advance of anyone ever having heard us play. And in the end, that didn't really work out too well. I mean, we were on the cover of 16 magazine before we had our first record out.
Well, he was a great publicist. Look,
yeah, he was a great publicist.
Well, look,
he's a terrible manager.
Eventually the band broke up over things that had probably less to do with music than they did with interpersonal dynamics.
Make me wise. Oh, it's all I believe in lies. I really don't know where to go. And I can't see a thing to open my eyes. 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 Can't see a thing to open my eyes.
Thank you.
I was not ready to step up and be the front man of anything after the Nas left. So the alternative for me, in order to stay involved with music and do something that I liked that had to do with the music business, was to move into the control room, essentially, and produce records for other people. And in the process, I picked up engineering as well, which turned out to be another marketable skill. But more importantly, it was a great asset in terms of production, because I was able to cut out the middleman in terms of sound.
So Albert Grossman, essentially, you're engineering for Bearsville. And
when I became a producer, yeah, it was in the Albert Grossman organization.
Right, who was Bob Dylan's manager and your manager for a while, and many other people. And was it a favor, kind of a side project, where he said, you know, you can make a record if you want?
No, I asked if I could make a record.
Okay.
I guess he said, oh, you can if you want, but they actually gave me a budget to do it, because I didn't do it in, well, there was no Bearsville studio yet when I did my first album. Even though I've been producing, it's not as if I stopped being a musician. I was still writing songs and I had musical ideas and liked to make records and wanted to have my own musical ideas on record. They were a bit taken aback when I delivered the record and they heard like this whole range of sort of musical ideas and also a song that they thought could be a hit single, which they then released and which then became a hit single up to a point.
We Gotta Get You a Woman.
It was called We Gotta Get You a Woman.
Leroy, boy, is that you? I thought your post-hanging days were through. Sunken eyes and full of sighs, tell no lies. You get wise, I tell you now.
When I was still a schoolboy, I was somewhat undersized. So I was called Runt because my name's Rundgren, but I was truly Runty all through my school years.
But you released a couple of solo albums under that name too, didn't you?
Well, the first album was, the title of it was Runt, but people for some reason took it as a band name or something like that. So I continued to use it even into the second album as a way to kind of make sure that the brand had not lost its impact. But after that, I decided I better just stick with my own name and avoid confusion in the future.
That I had no expectations commercially from my first record, even though it did have a hit single on it. I had no specific expectations from my second record, which nobody remembers, which was The Ballad of Todd Rundgren.
My most successful album was Something Anything, which was my third record. And because I, you know, still thought, like, as a record producer, the record to me was just an experiment in record making. It was not an attempt to build a foundation for a successful solo career.
Well, it wasn't originally intended to be a double album. It was only supposed to be a single album, but I had started developing almost a songwriting formula. And when I started making the record, I was writing a song every other day.
Once I get rolling, I will write and sing a song a day. And sometimes more than a song a day.
How it took a million tears just to prove they all were for you. But those days are through, cause it wouldn't have made any difference. If you love me, how could you love me when it wouldn't really make love me, you just didn't love me 'cause
I saw the light was, in a way, the beginning of the end of a certain approach to songwriting that I had. I was recording Something Anything, and I had a few tunes. I don't think I Saw the Light was one of the first tunes I had. Once I started the recording process, I began to write pretty regularly. And I remember just sitting down one day and, you know, knocking a few chords around, and came up with this idea and finished it in like 20 minutes. So it was an important song, both in terms of me having refined my my songwriting formula to the point that I could crank out a tune in 20 minutes, but also it made me reconsider that whole idea of writing songs around a formula and start to take the whole process a little bit more personally, I guess. Say Hello It's Me was a song that it was actually the first song that I ever wrote, and it was originally done in a very dirgy style by the Nazz, and I thought that I could give it a little bit more contemporary updating during the Something Anything sessions, the difference being, of course, that was a live performance, and most of the rest of Something Anything was me in the studio doing endless overdubs. So I saw it as an opportunity not just to revisit the song in a structural sense, but it was also a good platform for me to perform live.
During the course of making that record that I realized I was slipping into a formula of songwriting, which sort of bothered me. And then people started to refer to me as the male Carole King. And that bothered me even more. Not because, I mean, I was a fan of Carole King, but who wants to be constantly compared to another artist? You have to find something of your own.
Stone in their recent 20-year anniversary issue listed Todd as one of the great 100 records of the last...
Something Anything, yeah.
Something Anything, right.
Of the 100 records of the last 20 years. Yeah, right. That was a surprise, pleasant surprise, to find myself in there with Prince and whoever, you know, all the other... Michael Jackson and, you know, Rolling Stones. Yeah, it was...
Were you surprised at their selection of that record? Would you have selected a different one? Or thought it would be a different one?
Well, I think that they're... you know, that's an albatross for me that I'm not going to be able to shed easily. partially because of... not only the fact that it was the most commercially successful record that I had, but also because it was one of the first records that involved a solo artist playing all the instruments as well. So I think that they considered that to have some historical significance over and above the other records that I did that were done that way. It's not my favorite record, although I recognize it as a watershed record.
After Something Anything, I put out an album called The Wizard of True Start, and it was like a bomb went off. At the time, everyone thought it was a career suicide.
All right, why don't you step up to the mic and give it a try? No cigar. Why don't you give it a try?
It was nothing like any record. Not only wasn't it like Something Anything, it was continuous music from, you know, beginning to end, one side to the other, little snippets of found sounds and songs that flashed through my brains, half songs. I was trying more to map my musical consciousness directly onto a record.
You need your head. You need your head. You need your head. human.
Don't you think of anything but sex?
And I think what facilitated it, what made it all possible, was the fact that I had built my own studio just before starting the recording of this, and that created a sense of freedom. You know, call up some guys and say, I want to do a session in an hour and a half. Can you show up? I've got this little idea. And then we would lay it down. And then I could go back to tinkering around with stuff for as long as I liked, because we essentially owned the environment.
You know, there were actually no rules about it. Not only was I trying to get away from those specific sort of habits of writing music, I was looking at the form factor that I was working in that I had never actually stood back and looked at. By the time I got to A Wizard, A True Star, I want my material to at least mean something to me.
I'm a very selfish artist. I make records to please myself first and then to ideally please a larger audience. But I'm, you know, looking for entertainment in it as well as some, you know, strictly musical sort of statement.
But what it did do was, more than any of my other records, reveal more accurately what my personality is actually like. that what most people call rebelliousness, it doesn't have to be rebelliousness, it just has to be obstinance, that you see things a certain way and you're convinced that's the way that it's supposed to be.
Over time, people get attached to certain records, and as controversial as this record was when it was released, most of my fans, as much as they appreciate the songwriting of Something Anything and the hit singles, the record that most characterizes me in I think most fans' ears is A Wizard, A True Star.
But in the long run, it's turned out to be one of my most influential records. Artists like Prince cite it all the time.
Albert, you know, saw this as a kind of entertainment, you know, me delivering a record that upset everyone else. He was entertained by it, and he actually made some interesting contributions to the package of the record. It was his idea to put a postcard in there to have everyone fill out and send in, and eventually be part of the next records package. A lot of people thought it wasn't serious. A lot of people didn't want to give up the card because it was part of the package. But after the following record came out with a poster with everybody's name on it, we got about 10 or 20,000 cards after that, you know, thinking, oh, I'm just going to do this every record. I'm going to print people's names in the package.
Todd Rundgren presents an all-new album called simply Todd.
A million more soldiers will fade away.
It's a deluxe two-record set, Todd by Todd Rundgren, now available on Bearsville Records and Tape.
Records became exercises in mastering science at that point. They were all coming out longer than a normal record because I was no longer thinking in terms of songs that were supposed to live in any other context.
A little more humanity, please.
And if they ever found it to the radio, it's whatever, you know, but from my standpoint, I was evolving into an album artist.
Mm-hmm.
will fade away, but a dream goes on forever. I'm left standing here, I got nothing to say. All is silent within my dream. A thousand true loves will live and die, but a dream lives on forever. The days and the years will go streaking by, but the time has stopped in my dream.
I don't know how many records equals how many dollars. I don't know any of that stuff, you know, because I don't pay attention to that large an aspect of it. So I don't know. I know when it's selling good because everybody at the record company's happy. I know when it's selling bad because everybody at the record company's not so happy.
It's the biggest tragedy. You're so long ago and so far away, but my dream lives on forever. Yes, I believe that I'll see you one day, for without it there is no dream.
I never make them to be hit records or commercial whiz bang, you know. I just make them, and I have an explicit deal with the president of the record company that I make them and he sells them, and that never the twain shall meet.
And as time went on, you know, a number of my records that I never intended to be double albums had to be turned into double albums because of the excessive length of them. And whenever we could avoid that, then we would go through these, you know, mastering tortures, trying to get an excessive amount of music onto vinyl.
This is Todd Rundgren's Initiation. 68 minutes long. It's a record on Bearsville.
How do you compare your current group, Utopia, with the earlier Naz?
How can you compare them?
Decided that, okay, I'll be in a band, you know, and this band will be, you know, a musical cooperative, so that I don't have to, you know, write everything, and therefore it isn't all like on me, even though a lot of people refuse to take the focus off me. You know, they still wanted it to be about me more than they wanted it to be about a band.
Time for
were the members of the group Utopia brought together?
Through common projects previous to our going on the road. They played on my solo albums, either separately or in combinations, and this was my prime reason for using those particular people, was their familiarity, their initial familiarity with the material and what I was after. It's not a backup band for me, particularly. It's a band concept, which the Naz was. And the band, most of the bands that I had in the interim were just solo performance vehicle concepts rather than band concepts.
Stop with you.
Fortunately, the band came about in an era when that kind of music was becoming very popular, and eventually Utopia was filling arenas, you know, selling more tickets than I ever possibly could.
Quickly began to try and expand the range of what I was writing, and I think one of the principal impetuses was, you know, what's good to play guitar on? Writing songs around the opportunity to have guitar solos and things like that.
Who are still my fans, they went through that avenue. They weren't so much devoted to everything that I did as they were drawn in by the whole sort of Utopia thing, the big shows, the big long shows. You know, in those days we played like 4-hour sets and things like that, you know, but with three keyboard players and a guitar player all playing extended solos on every song.
You know, we have our own audience and our own kind of audience, and they usually sit and listen for the concert, and then at the end they freak out.
Roger would have been the first one to join the band. He came in to replace M. Frog, who was our synthesist. He was more of a treatment guy. You know, he'd do like sound effects and treat the sound of my guitar and stuff like that. And Roger, at the time, I believe he was a consultant at Moog and Art. He was consulting all these synthesizer companies. When Roger joined, it became apparent that he was not just a guy who made noises and things like that and treatments and that sort of shit. He could actually play the keyboard. Not too long before we did the second live album, Kevin Elman decided that he wanted to do something else. I met Willie because he was playing with Hall & Oates when I produced their third album, I guess it was. It was called War Babies. And Willie was the drummer on that. And Willie, I think when the spot became open, wanted to get into something more adventurous musically than what he thought was going to happen with Hall & Oates. So he joined the band while we were still a seven-piece.
Something happened just the other night. I had a vision in the middle of a daydream. In a place I'd never been before, I couldn't tell if I was still awake or sleeping. I saw so many things.
And guys in the band started to want to move on to other things. And I believe the first one to leave was Ralph Schuckett. He was tired of the road and he wanted to do something else, get involved in something else. Eventually, Moogie decided he wanted to produce records or something. So he left, and Roger was then the only keyboard player left. And then eventually, we were a four-piece for a little while with John Siegler, still on bass. And then John decided that he didn't want to go on the road anymore. He was getting married. And so he left the band as well. And we had to find another bass player and held auditions. And I don't know how Chasm got the word, but he came up. And, you know, at first he just seemed really young. You know, we thought, this guy's just a kid. You know, how's he gonna fit in? But he was a good, solid bass player, and he had a good, clear, high voice, which was something that was useful. But that pretty much was what turned out to be the final permutation of Utopia.
Welcome to the new world. Utopia. Utopia.
Don't Chasm Sultan, Willie Wilcox, the recording, the performance, the experience, Utopia, Raw.
A lot of people like to take these things a little more seriously than they really are. A lot of people think that if we do a tour that is as coherent as, for instance, the Raw tour was, that there's some kind of a religious cult behind it or something like that, where it's just an attempt to do a coherent show and to pick a theme that allows us to incorporate all of the different things that we're trying to do into something that appears to be coherent. And that's what the Raw tour was. It wasn't meant to be the band moving to Egypt and setting up house. You know, it was just simply the unifying concept for an album and a tour. You know, we don't have any particular philosophy that has anything to do with Egypt or Egyptology.
Well, that would be, you know, literally physically dangerous. When I would have to walk up the pyramid and flip off the top, that was literally, yeah, potentially kill yourself kind of dangerous. But I always felt that the reason why people want to see a performance is because it's out of the ordinary. It isn't safe. Once you start it, you can't stop it.
This album, oops, wrong planet. How did that come about?
That was just one of a number of titles that we wrote down on a piece of paper at the last minute,
right,
and gave to the record company to pick one out, because we had thought about it so long that we couldn't be objective any longer about what the title would be for the album. And that seemed to pop out.
This is Todd Rundgren. There's a new Utopia album out. It's called Oops, Wrong Planet. It sounds sort of like this. From Utopia, Oops, Wrong Planet, on Bears Hill Records and Tapes.
Planet, which was one that was got scathing reviews when it first came out, and really didn't do that well commercially, except for the fact that it had something of a very minor hit for us. It later became a hit for England, Dan and John Ford Coley, but that one always scores very high for some reason, you know. And I think the reason why is because it's one of the records where you can really hear the personality of the band. The ones they like best are the ones that are much more raw and much less ornate and contain a real sort of black and white picture of what the band is wanting.
Can't stop love in action.